Hi everyone, we are actually in the Museum of Contemporary Art of Vojvodina and we are preparing the exhibition under the title Transformatorium. It shows the last 7-8 years of work of mine and my partner Rena Rädle, and we have been working with these works quite long actually, and most of the works have been actually exhibited in the public spaces. They are made for public spaces intervention, and now it is a completely another process to bring it in the museum and to use it in the museum space. And for this process we actually need approximately 10 days of installation just to think about how to put them together in the different shapes and different forms. We have made a plan in 3D, in different kind of techniques, how to shape it and how to deal with the space. But it is very important process for us because most of the works are not usual piece of art. It's not framed photo or picture that you just put on the wall and you need a nail to nail it down.
Yeah.
But it is, those are actually flags, banners, quite unusual objects that we actually used in another contexts, and we want now to have this object in completely another constellation. Of course, the museum space give us in one hand opportunity, in another hand it is a kind of conservative white cube. And therefore we decided to have a part of our works outside. So in front of the museum, in the park and at the plateau of the museum, there are works which are made for the public space in Zagreb, which we have been produced in 2018.
That's one I wanted to mention, because normally this type of works normally comes to small galleries.
I would say that the Museum of Contemporary Art of Vojvodina is a bit of more experimental if you compare to other institutions in Serbia, and it is open for new forms, for new strategies. And it is also very important to say that this city, actually Novi Sad and also the Vojvodina region, it has this strong tradition of the avant-garde, of the neo-avant-garde from the 70s, and also from Subotica many artists have been also part of this, like for example Bosch and Bosch group.
The last time I saw this kind of the style of your images was like in the 1910s, idea of socialism and
a socially engaged art from the period of after the avant-garde and
So I need to ask that you have also that kind of message, or is just completely different?
Yes, there is a tradition of this propaganda style of, but not of socialist realism in the 50s or 30s. I think we are more connected to this idea of the art which is socially engaged from 20s. And there is this kind of relation, especially at the work which is outdoor. There is a strong reference to Croatian group which was existing in the between two wars, 20s and 30s. The name of the group was the Earth, Zemlja in Croatian. And this group was specially oriented toward socially engaged art. This was a connection between them and also, for example, people like John Hartfield or Georg Gross in Germany, or in Hungary you also had this kind of socially engaged artist in this period at the beginning of 20th century, using graphic and very simple message to communicate and so on. I think this is a part actually of European culture in a way.
You started a YouTube channel.
Yes.
How to draw, and I have a simple idea that this is because of the crisis, because we cannot move to a museum or cannot go to a gallery to see art. Did you had the feeling that you must show everything what you can, or you just started this channel to inspire others for drawing?
We started this channel, Rena and me, of course during the COVID crisis. And many artists started to this kind of communication in that period. But as I told you, we have had something in 2019 actually. Before this, we had one work which was dealing exactly only with digital images and drawing, how to draw it and so on. We wanted to get to the format of the YouTube channel, you know, mm-hmm. and to see how we can deal with this format. And in that format you cannot really do much. There are some rules of the camera, of the time, of the visibility, of the, you know, structure, how it should be also represented in the channel, how long you talk, how long you draw. You know, there are already some rules which have been established by the viewers and also during the years of TV and YouTube existence. Because, for example, Bob Ross, you know, you remember this famous TV actually painter, is some kind of proto YouTube channelist. Of course, it was happening in the TV, but you can say that this form, how he was doing this in 20 minutes or in 30 minutes. And for us, you know, it was very interesting to try to draw without any cut. So the drawing is starting from the without cut, so yeah. There is no mistake, you know, it is like some kind of performative way how to deal with this and to see like what is the outcome, because you cannot predict it. I mean, it can happen that you make some mistake, you cannot go reverse, yeah. because you record everything, you know, and you cannot edit. If you edit, then it is something virtual, you know, and we want just to do it without cut, and mm-hmm. if you watch it, there is no cut.
Usually when I see drawing videos, there are a lot of cuts, and then it makes the video feels a quick process. But you sometimes just step back and see the whole picture at once. So it's a kind of slowness.
It is some kind of slowness, but we managed to make one video in 7 minutes. Mm-hmm. And this is the shortest one. Other are like 15 minutes, 20 minutes. But you need a lot of energy to do that. I mean, after 50 minutes of doing this, you feel very exhausted. I was extremely exhausted because I cannot really predict how the colors will do it in such a fast way. Mm-hmm. And this is the challenge. This is very interesting. Because you don't know at the end what will happen, what it will be. It's like that this media and this format is leading you to the outcome. So it's like artificial intelligence is leading you and you are just a channel of the hand of artificial intelligence. So there is no author anymore and artist is disappearing and what is left is only artificial intelligence that is painting instead of mm-hmm. the human. So this is also the message in a way.
Well, actually when I think about similar artists, well, kind of similar, like Ferenc Gróf or Dan Perjovsky, mm-hmm. they also have, they want to have an impact on the society. Like when Dan Perjovsky draws someone who goes into a supermarket, I want to buy a banana, and then comes out from the shop with full of bags. Oh, I forgot the bananas. So this is about that. Hey guys, wait a little, something goes wrong. And I have the same feeling in your pictures, but I'm not sure if it's intentional or not.
I mean, it's very good that you mentioned this aspect, because of course we are socially engaged and we have this very strong relation to society. And most of the objects that we exhibit here and the artworks are related to something which was grounded in the social situation. For example, we exhibit banners which have been used at the protest, or in Graz, in Austria, for example. Or we use some objects that have been used at the big carnival. So most of the objects have been used in different contexts, in different forms, in different formats, and they have been always connected to the society, so, and to the social movements, to the social embodiment, you know. So for us it is very important, because if it is just some imagination out from the blue sky, this work is not doesn't has its social substance, and this work will not really be so strong. And you see that. I mean, if you go to, I don't know, to see any kind of the great masters or something like that, I mean, I don't know, you go to Prado and you see Velázquez, you find out that he was deeply involved in the court, in the Spanish court. In back then, in the 17th century, and he was organizing all kind of processions and rituals for Spanish Habsburgs. And I think that art must always step beyond its own field, and then it will become strong when it is, you know, entering other fields of economy, of politics, of ideology. Then it is strong.
So what is interesting about you, that you work in a group, as a couple, and like Gilbert and George, or the Hungarian Borsos Lőrinc, who is actually it's one name, but it's two separate people. And when I thought about that, how is it possible to work together? Because I'm also an artist and I'm making art, but for me, that sharing my art with someone, or even let other people to do something in my art, is a bit problematic. So how is it easy for you to share all this this art?
Yeah, it's a good question. Of course, there is both of us are strong personalities. We actually adapt our art to other. So Rena adapts her work to my part, and I adopt my part to her work. I mean, we are working since almost 20 years. So this is not that we just started from yesterday. It has been a very challenging and very beautiful experience. And this moves us further and further. And we have been also, we are changing our work all the time. So, because we are two, we have different media, different expressions, different ideas how to shape it, how to express it. I think this is a quality, but for this you need a lot of patience. So we try to keep the balance with this. So this is some kind of message after all.
Previously you mentioned that you will exhibit some works outside of the museum, and I saw some of that. And that means for me that you want to maybe invite the people from the park to the exhibition.
Yes.
And I have doubts about the newest generation, about how much they want to go into museum and see artwork. Maybe just on the phone, or I don't know, but. But of course, there are examples for the other side as well. But how do you think is this kind of art, and I mean this white cube museum space, will exist in 100 years?
I think some forms of archiving, showing, having this spatial relation and so on, will of course exist. I mean, this is. The man can be in relation to many things. But we see that with many things which are in real world, I mean, in the real but we see that it is not so easy to talk about the future today, because we are living in some kind of risk society, you know, and we don't know what will happen with the institutions of museum at all. It is connected with the society and also with the state, with the public. I mean, if public is not anymore there as a notion of commons and public, and if state become only some kind of service for commercial, for economy, which it is right now, it goes more into this direction, then the museums will not be anymore active in that sense. And I hope that museum will maybe transform into something more dynamic, because the idea of the museum is also something very conservative. I mean, you conservate something, you put something in practically in some category and lock it down. So it's it is it has also to do with the commemorative practices, which is not really something which celebrates life. So I think the museum needs to learn to celebrate life and then it will survive. So this is this is also my message for the whole museum. So let's celebrate life and not celebrate some kind of boring and conservative practices of humankind.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you for asking us.